After over 100 hours of gameplay, countless crashes, destroying the cartridge for a download code only for it to be resurrected by my ex-wife Chili, who tried selling it to Funko Land so she could buy pills, and then condemning the zombie cartridge into purgatory for all eternity where it belongs, I think it's safe to say that the nightmare of the Persona Q cartridge is finally behind me once and for all. You know what? I'm the kind of guy who likes to plan ahead, so I'm not gonna take any chances of Persona Q's sequel coming back for revenge someday. So that's why I'm gonna nip it in the bud right here and now by destroying the cartridge for that game, and this time I'm gonna bury it somewhere where my ex-wife Chili's never gonna find it. That way, there's not gonna be anything left in my way of pursuing my lifelong dream of becoming a proctologist. So without further ado... Whoa, buddy! Who are you?
I'm you, dude, from 2 minutes into the future. And I'm here to rock your mind, cause I'm bad radical.
Okay. Well, why are you dressed like that?
Because it's the style of my times, jabroni.
Well, I think you look like a hippo's granddaughter.
Predictable old man.
Old man, I'm 2 minutes younger than you. Never mind. What are you even doing here?
One thing I'm not here for is to ravage your supple body, so you park your keister right back in that chair, meester.
I know.
The only reason I'm here is to stop you from making the biggest mistake of your life by cutting that Persona Q cartridge in half just to work at a dead-end job as an astronaut.
Astronaut? No. I'm destroying this cartridge so I can be a proctologist. You know, those doctors who repair headaches in people's asses.
Yeah, well, where I come from, those two jobs traded names along with a few terms related to them.
That actually does make sense, but how is it so much of a dead-end job that it makes not destroying Persona Q 2 a better use of my time?
Well, first of all, chump, most people just use phones to fix their asses in the future. And secondly, that there game's hard to find even in your time. But after the already limited supply gets destroyed in the Great Catastrophe, even a loose cartridge like that's gonna end up being worth billions.
Wait, Great Catastrophe?
Yeah, a giant hemorrhoid crashes into the Earth and wipes out about 69% of the population. So you'd better make sure you get 2 million sunblock or you're about to have a real bad day, get it?
Jesus. I can't believe how expensive a Persona Q game is gonna be in the future. But I don't buy games just to hoard them and resell them someday, especially when I already have so many great 3DS games that are begging for a spot on the shelf as it is.
You think I'd travel through time just to scalp a game? Nah, chump, you need to expand your mind. The main reason I'm trying to stop you from destroying that cartridge is because Persona Q 2 ends up going down as one of the all-time greatest 3DS games ever made.
I just don't see how it's possible. I mean, Persona Q 1 was 100 hours of decency. There's no way that the sequel could have improved so much where it's better than a real game like one of those butt simulators you get to play as a astronaut.
Oh, you mean SimAss 2000. That game's aged even worse than GoldenEye. Only a geezer like you would want to play that, but Persona Q 2, on the other hand, is a game that everybody, including me, wants to play.
I suppose I'll give it a try, but if it's not better than the original, then I'm cutting this cartridge in half right here and now.
Whatever, Grandpa.
Alright, so with this game coming out at a time where the Persona franchise was more popular than ever, you'd think that it would have sold assloads of copies, but since this game came out on the 3DS after the Switch was already tearing ass around the backyard, most people absolutely refused to give it a chance. I mean, the game did alright in Japan, all things considered, but not good enough to bother dubbing it into English for a Western release, which is actually why a lot of people didn't bother picking it up. And even though I usually prefer watching movies or TV shows in whatever their native languages are, I can totally understand not feeling like reading text for dozens of hours, especially for a franchise where the English voice actors are pretty damn good. Well, I mean, for the most part, anyway.
The enemy is a Hierophant. That skill seems to scare its enemy.
Since Atlus didn't even bother using their whole ass on this one, then I can't say that I blame anyone for skipping a spin-off on an outdated handheld. Although to be fair, I can't imagine that hiring like 40 different voice actors would have been worth it for a 3DS game that most people just weren't gonna buy no matter what anyway, so I suppose it is what it is. I mean, if Atlus ever plans on releasing Q2 in any form in the future then, I kinda feel like they should have paid for the voice actors now and gotten it out of the way in the 3DS, but since they didn't, I think it's safe to say that my future self's telling the truth, even if he is kinda being a dick about it and smoking my stepson's cigarette collection.
Hey man, he's my stepson too! Besides, in the future, you'll be able to buy smokes like these in spades, Jack!
Now, is it dumb for Atlus to think so short-term in an era where pretty much everything's re-released like 37 times? Of course, but Atlus has been known to do things that don't make sense ever since the colonial days. Hell, the fact that the Persona Q games are exclusive to a console that doesn't even have the mainline games doesn't make sense in the first place. So honestly, I can't really say that I'm surprised that these two games are gonna be trapped on the 3DS for at least 2 more minutes. And, well, like I said in another video specifically dedicated to the possibility of Persona Q games coming over to other consoles, I really don't think that Atlus should do that anytime soon anyway. Unless another Wii U comes along, these games are just not going to be the same without having a second screen dedicated to drawing all the maps out, which was pretty much the entire appeal of these games in the first place. Or at least it was for Persona Q 1 anyway, but you know what, maybe 2 is going to be different, so let's take a gander. Okay, so unlike the first game, Q2 only lets you play as Joker rather than letting you choose between all the protagonists, and I can totally understand why some people would hate this, but personally, after spending 100 hours in the first game, I'm kinda glad that I'm not gonna be tempted to play through the sequel multiple times just to see the same story from slightly different perspectives. Cause I mean, honestly, how long do you really need these games to keep you occupied for, you know? I mean, I've been ripped off far worse in a game only lasting 70 hours as opposed to 100. In fact, I actually kind of prefer so I can move on to other games in my backlog. Besides, I gotta say that focusing on just one story actually makes Q2 flow so much better in my opinion, and I mean, it's not like you're forced to keep the main character in your party at all times anyway, so if you really want to use one of the other protagonists, then knock yourself out.
Don't mind if I do!
While there might not be one character that Persona Q2 forces you to have in your party at all times, though, it does take a good bit longer to unlock the full cast from all the mainline games. So sorry to say, but if you only bought this game for the Persona 3 protagonist's haircut, then you're gonna have to be patient for about 20 hours or so. But to be completely honest, I actually feel like sprinkling all the characters out little by little is actually one of the biggest improvements made in this game. You see, in Persona Q1, you go through the first dungeon with the full cast of whichever game you chose, and then the full cast from the other game just kinda shows up all at once, and personally, I thought this was a little bit overwhelming. I mean, I totally get why there's so many characters in both of the Persona Q games, but in pretty much any RPG ever, you gain new party members one by one as the story progresses, and I really think that's the way that it ought to be. Not only does it give you something to look forward to, knowing that there's still more characters that have yet to join the party, but it also makes every character feel way more important to have their own spotlight for a little bit when they finally do join. However, given that there's over 25 party members in Persona Q2, or 28 if you count the navigators, then there really is no way to ease them all in at once, so all things considered, I think the fine chaps at Atlus really did a good job here. I mean, I feel bad for whoever had to program like 27,000 different weapons and armor that most people are only going to use for like 5 minutes before they unlock more upgrades, but real quick while we're on the topic of equipment, why the frig do I have to appraise items in order to get slightly better accessories? Like, either just let me find them in the wild or pay a little more for them in shops. I don't want to deal with the hassle of getting Theo's hot dog ass to tell me what I have, nor do I feel like dealing with these complicated benefits to try and decide which equipment's an asshair better. But anyway, back to there being 28 different playable characters though, it does kinda suck that you can only have 5 party members with you at any given time, or 7 if you include the navigators. Although again, you're not forced to use any of the protagonists anyway, and thankfully Q2's original characters never actually join you in battle anyway, so unlike the first game, you're not gonna find yourself being stuck with some dingus you'd be embarrassed to be seen with in public. But also unlike the first game, sometimes specific party members are motivated with beefed up stats, and the side quests usually recommend that you bring specific party members along with you as well, which encourages you to give everyone a chance to shine, and I honestly think that's pretty neat. I mean, you're rarely forced to bring anyone in particular, but I always take the game's recommendations just for the variety and the stat boosts. Speaking of side quests though, this is yet another area where Q2 completely trumps the first game. And honestly, I really hope that Q1's thinking about this while it's rotten down there in purgatory.
Achoo! Unbelievable, does nobody around here say Nostrovia anymore?
Nostrovia.
Dziękuję bardzo, Sławek.
Man, whenever the first game hit me with side quests, it always felt like my Uncle Eddie was stopping by unannounced wanting to borrow some money.
Open the door!
Damn it.
I got a gift for you.
Go away, go away. Freaking go away, you freak.
Did you do something behind the couch?
Yeah, I did. I lost peace and quiet. What do you need? What do you want?
However, whenever side quests pop up in Persona Q2, on the other hand, though, I'm usually pretty excited, because not only are the short stories within them an ass hair more entertaining than they were in Persona Q1, but the actual tasks here are genuinely fun as well. I mean, in the first game, it'd usually just be like, I don't know, just go somewhere on the third floor and beat a specific enemy, I guess. But you also gotta do it with a specific move or it doesn't count, though. However, 2Q, on the other hand, gets a little bit more creative, like having you do things like solve mysteries with Naoto and Akechi. Plus, instead of wandering around like a goon through areas you've already explored, the side quests here at least add treasure maps and block areas of the map off that you're not gonna end up using to keep you from blowing your brains out. And as if that wasn't enough of an improvement, this game actually keeps track of all 45 of your side quests, whereas I couldn't even tell you how many side quests there were in the first game since they'd kinda just come and go whenever. What really steams my clams about side quests in the first game is that sometimes they'd only be available for a limited time, and honestly, sometimes I just didn't feel like doing them right away, mainly because they just weren't very fun. However, since they'd expire once you moved on to the next floor, I constantly had to go back to the entrance after finding the exit rather than opening up the next floor.
Ugh.
Nobody says steamed my clams anymore, you old fogey.
Go count your dick, future me.
Like I said, predictable.
Honestly, I'm not even 100% sure that side quests don't expire in Persona Q2, but since I genuinely wanted to do them as soon as I could, it doesn't really matter anyway. But aside from the side quests, though, Persona Q2 pretty much blows the first game out of the water in every other area imaginable, except for maybe the story, I suppose. I'm gonna try to keep spoilers to a minimum here, but basically all the Persona characters from four different games are magically warped from their worlds, times, or in the case of Persona 3's female protagonist, alternate universes. Then they're trapped inside of a movie theater that exists in an alternate dimension or whatever where time doesn't flow. And also in this movie theater, though, is a girl named Hikari who's watching the same depressing movies over and over again to the point where her self-esteem's pretty much shot. So the idea, more or less, is to physically go inside of each movie to change the ending so that they're more uplifting. However, since the Persona characters were all warped into separate movies, the villains within those movies are all altered to resemble other characters from the mainline series. And personally, I really like this, because it makes the game feel more like a Persona crossover rather than some game that happens to use Persona characters for no real reason. Man, I feel like most people would probably prefer the first game story, but while I'd agree that it definitely had the better ending, I found that the sequel had me entertained far more often from start to finish, mainly because the actual Persona characters were more involved as opposed to Zen and Rei hogging the spotlight like that random married couple from Jurassic Park 3 that weren't even in the first two movies and haven't been seen since. I know the main goal is to help Hikari, but for like 3/5 of Persona Q2, you're trying to help Persona characters reunite with the rest of their teams. Not to mention, each movie having its own self-contained story keeps everything feeling fresh while making you look forward to what's coming next. And I also really like the dynamic of Persona 3's female protagonist feeling out of place because the rest of her crew doesn't recognize her, what with her being from an alternate universe where a male counterpart doesn't exist. I mean, it'd have been pretty friggin' weird if all the Persona 3 characters just kinda knew both of the protagonists, even though they'd never even been in the same game. Pretty sure saying I like the story of the second game better is gonna start a mush pit in the comments, but again, I can't really get into it too much without talking about spoilers, so if you want me to go into more detail about it, then give me a call on my personal cell phone number and we'll have a little chat about it.
All I know is that it sounds like a much better story than some kind of a cheap, stupid, and shameless one-to-shows knockoff.
Much like the first game, some of the filler dialogue can be a little unnecessary sometimes, but I still find myself to be annoyed far less often than I was with the first game. But even so, I really wish that someone would just tell Atlus that it's really not necessary for Chie to tell us how much she loves meat as often as she does. Don't get me wrong, I still think Chie is awesome. In fact, I even made her my waifu in my second playthrough of Persona 4 Golden.
Get your meat ass out here and have some fun with me!
All I'm saying is maybe a little less meat references from this point forward, you know? However, as annoying as Chia's meat madness may be, one thing that's 1,000 times more annoying is the gimmick where Marie leaves poems on the ground in the Velvet Room. I mean, I swear, Atlus likes milking this shtick more than the Persona franchise itself, except here it's literally the exact same thing over and over again with no variety whatsoever. I mean, I go into the Velvet Room with the intention of fusing personas or whatever, and much like Jackie Chan in pretty much every movie he's ever been in, I don't want trouble. But every now and then, you'll see a note on the ground with Marie's poems written on them, and then the game automatically reads them without your consent, only for Marie to catch you right after and get mad. Rinse and repeat, rinse and repeat, rinse and repeat. My god, I swear, the feeling I get from seeing this message and having to sit through all these poems is even worse than making eye contact with an old coworker or classmate out in public and having to endure all the small talk. Maybe I'd appreciate these a little bit more if I liked poetry, but my god, all this dialogue's completely pointless to me. No exaggeration, all these poems might as well just be in gibberish to me as far as I'm concerned. As a matter of fact, even friggin' Butthead came up with a better poem than anything that's ever come out of Marie's dingus brain.
The phone is ringing, and I cannot linger. So look out, butt. Here comes my finger.
And look, I know that this complaint should really be directed towards Persona 4 Golden where the problem started, since Q2 included it was kinda just to be faithful, but to put it mildly, I would just prefer to never see this bit again. But to move on to something a little more positive though, the battles here are more or less the same as they were in the first game, just with more party members. However, since it's a fun battle system though, I've got no problem with there being so few changes, although I do wish the game would stop trying to nudge me into using baton passes. Sure, they might be great in Persona 5, but in Q2, I just never saw it as something that was worth using 2 support points for, although I'm pretty sure there's probably times where it's actually useful. All I'm saying is I just never saw them as all. Just like the first game, you still divide characters up between a front and a back row, but rather than the game labeling characters as front and back, they're instead labeled as physical, defense, magic, or support, which is basically just a less lazy way of saying front and back. Each character still uses the personas from the mainline games, along with the ability to equip a secondary sub-persona, but in addition to all that junk, this game's got unison attacks, which are double, triple, and sometimes quadruple team moves with characters from all the different games you can unlock by completing side quests. This isn't really that big of a deal, I guess, but I really like how there's sub-personas in this game with abilities that the navigators could actually use. I mean, like, what the frig's Risei supposed to do with a move like Brutal Slash, you know? Drawing maps out might not be everyone's thing, but much like the first game, I think it's a lot more fun than you think if you give it a chance, even though the game pretty much tells you where to put everything anyway. It is still a little bit annoying how dungeons are basically designed to make you take extra steps to fill the map out just so you get into more random encounters and inflate your playtime. But even though there are still a lot of dead ends on the maps in this game, though, they do at least almost always lead to unlocking new side quests, unique dialogue, and sometimes the side quests even utilize these areas later on. So even though dead ends do still exist in this game, they at least don't waste nearly as much time as the first game did. Besides, they're still a lot better than what happens to dead ends in real life, so I guess I can't complain. Honestly, after playing so much Persona Q lately, looking at these characters in the mainline games is starting to feel as weird as seeing realistic drawings of Mario. While the chibi art style itself didn't really change all that much in Q2, though, the game went above and beyond in the style department, which is saying a lot since I still thought the first game looked really good. Honestly, Persona Q2 is probably the best looking 3DS game to date, so it's pretty easy to see why it still holds up even 2 minutes into the future. And not only is it gorgeous, but holy poop is this soundtrack incredible. Pretty much every background song in this entire game is just plain nice and fits every situation perfectly. Somebody needs to give this Shoji guy a friggin' raise. I did like a few songs in the first game, but Q2 is completely on par with any mainline game in the series, with musical styles and singers from all the games blending together perfectly. I mean, Persona Q1 did kinda blend the two musical styles together, I guess, but while the battle music in that game was great, it was still just the same song recorded twice with two different singers depending on which cast you chose. But Persona Q2, on the other hand, had a completely original battle theme for Persona 3, Persona 3 Portable, Persona 4, and Persona 5 with the same singers and styles from those games, and they're all absolute classics in video game music. Normally, whenever I'm playing RPGs, I tend to listen to podcasts and things of that nature whenever I'm trucking along through a dungeon without any dialogue, but Persona Q2 is a game where I just couldn't do that. And if for whatever reason you don't like any of these songs in particular, then you could always take them out of the queue, but personally, I think keeping them all in there to play at random makes enemy encounters a little more exciting, since the song that's going to be playing when you open up a can of ass-whips always going to be a surprise. And honestly, it's for the music alone why I almost never ran away from battles or used items to avoid enemies for the entire playthrough, and honestly, I think more RPGs ought to have multiple battle themes. But another thing that makes me not want to run away from battles is how much better the dungeons flow in this game as opposed to all the backtracking the first one had you dealing with. If I got one nitpick with the exploration though, then it'd probably be whether the game makes you actually cross through shortcuts in order to open them up. Like, why can't I just touch them instead of actually passing through them? I don't want to go back right now, I just want to be able to come through them later. But oh well, at least the game gives you the option to start on any floor you want, unlike the first game, and the fact that you automatically heal whenever you leave a dungeon's awesome. I mean, I don't mind paying money to heal in RPGs, but it was pretty friggin' annoying in the first game when I'd heal up and then change a persona or equipment or something, only to have to heal again. While Persona Q2 may clearly be better than the first game, there are a few more negatives that I'm legally obligated to point out. For example, one thing that the first game has that the second one actually doesn't is the ability to play in 3D. And look, I know everyone including Nintendo themselves stopped caring about 3D about halfway through the 3DS's lifespan, and I'd bet like $15 so there wasn't even one person in the world who wouldn't buy a game just because it wasn't in 3D, even though I'm sure someone's bound to lie about it just to spite me in the comments. So it's really not that big of a deal that one of the final 3DS games ever made didn't have this one feature that nobody used, although I do think it's funny that Elizabeth actually wears 3D glasses in the game, which tells me that Atlus probably originally wanted Q2 to be in 3D until their CEO, Johnny Atlus, stopped the team at the last minute. No! But another thing that I didn't quite care for, though, is that since the cutscenes are so long in this game, I kinda wish that it'd let you save whenever you wanted. I know you can just close your 3DS, but some of these cutscenes are like 30 minutes long, so what am I supposed to do when my landlord comes over and wants to play Sonic Boom, you know? But as far as comparisons of the first game go, my biggest complaint would definitely be that I wish the Persona 3 and 4 characters remembered each other. Cause I mean, after all, the game is supposed to be a sequel, you know? I mean, the fact that everyone's gotta meet each other for the first time all over again kinda makes this more of a reboot than a sequel. I mean, I'd imagine that there were probably a fair amount of people who skipped Q2 just because they never played the first one, so if it's gonna be a reboot, then I kinda feel like they should've at least been more clear about it. Not only that, but seeing all these characters reintroduce themselves to each other just makes me feel like the first game didn't count, which kinda sucks after I spent 100 hours on it. I know you might say that none of these characters were ever supposed to remember any of this, but Atlus themselves have gone on record to say that Persona Q is in fact canon. And look, I totally get that it'd been weird for half the characters to know each other and not the other half. But I don't know, I'd have liked the game way better if they'd at least gotten their memories back at the very end or something, just so people like me who'd gone through what the first game put us through got a little bonus for our efforts is all. But you know what, even all these nitpicks are pretty minor in the grand scheme of things, because Persona Q2 is an all-around fun game that improves just about everything that was good and bad about the original. Like I said in my last video, playing Persona Q was pretty fun under the right circumstances, but overall, it just felt like a chore, which is why it took me over 2 years to find the willpower to finish it. But with Persona Q2, on the other hand, though, I was always looking forward to playing it whenever I couldn't, like whenever I was stuck coaching my stepdad's stupid-ass t-ball team. That's mainly because it was a lot more straightforward and easier to play in short bursts than the first game was, like all good handheld games should be. Best of all, Persona Q 2 didn't even crash on me one time, which I was honestly afraid would happen, because not only would Atlus have never believed me, but I'm sure nobody on the internet would have either, so it's not like I could have at least made another wacky video about it without getting my Blockbuster membership revoked. So if I had to give Persona Q 2 a score, then I'd easily give it a 1 out of 1, no questions asked, which is saying a lot since I don't just give those out willy-nilly. But as much as I really did like Persona Q 2, I'm still a bit skeptical that it's better than SimAss 2000. So even though I can't find it inside of me to destroy this cartridge, I bet I probably could if I had a butt doctor degree. So sorry to say, future me, but I think I'm gonna sell this cartridge now so I can chase my dreams rather than hoard it to become a multi-billionaire in the distant future.
Not so fast, old man.
Whoa! Let's take it easy now. Remember, if you kill me, you die too.
I'd rather be dead than go back to my time without that game. So you hand that cartridge over right now, you hear me? And don't try anything funny, because I know everything you're gonna do.
Yeah, well, you may know everything that I'm gonna do, but that doesn't mean that you know what I'm not gonna do. So all I have to do is not download that ping image of a gun, and you won't be able to shoot me.
What the? Damn it! You idiot! Don't you realize how big of a mistake you just made?
Whatever, just go back to your time machine and frig back off to the future, you butt wagon.
Time machine? Who said anything about a time machine?
Wait, then how'd you get here, magic?
Nah, chump. Drugs. You see, our ex-wife Chili tried robbing my house so she could sell Persona Q 2 to finally get her pills. But all she could find was some old DMT she left under the sink when her and the maintenance guy were, fixing the sink.
Fixing the sink.
Yeah. Yeah.
Not cheating.
She didn't cheat on us. But anyway, Chili's specially made DMT wasn't anything you could find anywhere else, because it had the power to not only alter your dreams, but also let you ignore the rules of space and go into anybody's dreams throughout human history.
Wait, does he mean to tell me we're dreaming right now?
Yeah, chump. Why do you think you spent 70 hours playing a game without turning into me?
Because it was funnier to not try and bring logic to such a preposterous gag?
Nah, it's because time doesn't flow in here, just like in the Persona Q games.
Alright, let me guess, when we wake up, we're not gonna remember anything either, huh?
See.
Well, the one I just cut the cartridge in half when I wake up?
Nah, kook, because giving that game a perfect score triggered a change of heart, so you're not gonna wanna break it. And because you won't remember playing it, you're not gonna wanna sell it either.
Alright, so how do we get out of here?
All you gotta do is say Mordecai 3 times.
Wait, why the... Whatever. Mordecai, Mordecai... Hey. Did you by chance ever happen to find that back scratcher that I misplaced?
Yeah, it's hidden behind all your amiibos.
Oh, what do you know? There it is. Well, thanks. Mordecai, Mordecai, Mordecai. Mordecai, Mordecai, Mordecai. I guess I dozed off for a second there. Sorry. Where was I? Oh yeah. I was gonna destroy Persona Q 2 so this son of a bitch doesn't try to get revenge on me. But on second thought, I don't know. Maybe I should hold on to it for a little while, you know? Man, I don't feel like playing it right now, but, you know, maybe someday I will. Oh, hold on. Oh. Wow. That's weird. I just got a notice on my phone saying there's a giant asteroid headed towards the Earth, and apparently now they're called hemorrhoids. But anyway, sorry we didn't get to go on any kind of wacky adventures today or anything like that, but I should probably get over to my neighbor Terry's bomb shelter right about now. So in the meantime, maybe you'll get a kick out of my review of the first Persona Q game, since I'm probably never gonna find the time to play the second one. Later.
So I want to say thank you to your loyalty, thank you for your support.